Hi everybody, Dr. A again, and I've got a video for you on Lean Six Sigma, and we're going to look over some basic principles of Lean Six Sigma. So medical errors are much more frequent than previously thought. Lean and Six Sigma are two impactful quality management systems. So Lean focuses on reducing waste, so streamlining a process to reduce wait times, or modifying a process to reduce cost. It eliminates non-value adding steps and it reduces cycle time. This can be something as simple as looking at the layout of the lab. So imagine you are a lab tech and you are working in chemistry on one of the big analyzers, and often those analyzers require reagents that need to be loaded pretty frequently, especially if you're doing high volume. And maybe some quality control, some calibrations. And what you want is you want those supplies, which often have to be refrigerated, to be in a refrigerator that is near the analyzer. And if that fridge was on the other side of the lab, then the tech that is working in chemistry would be wasting a lot of time walking across the lab and back to get reagents, quality control, and all of that. And so those are, you know, it's non-value adding time and steps and effort when if the fridge was closer, then they could be more productive and things could take less time. So that's just a very simple example. Six Sigma is a methodology that focuses on reducing variability by identifying and eliminating causes of defects and errors. The process sigma is the number of defects per million opportunities. In the lab, it would be per million tests. And the sigma is the number of standard deviations outside of the mean that a process can move before it is outside of acceptable limits, or basically what I would say, how far off the range it can go before it's really a problem. Quality improvement is a combination of Lean and Six Sigma, which achieves new levels of performance not otherwise realized through quality control alone. The application of Lean and Six Sigma principles can reduce the test turnaround time, improve the productivity of the lab staff, and improve the quality of lab results. So let's look at the quality improvement team roles. So the project coach leader is usually a black belt in Lean or Six Sigma. Black belt coaches spend as much as 100% of their time on quality improvement projects. Black belts have training at all levels, so yellow and green, with additional training in statistical analyses, coaching, and facilitation, and several successful projects under their belts. The project team members can be green and yellow belts. The green belt focuses on understanding and applying the five phases of the Six Sigma process, and have at least one successful project that they have completed. A yellow belt has received a full day of basic Lean Six Sigma training, and these green and yellow belts can be lab staff members with subject expertise. So maybe it's the blood bank lead tech or something if there's a problem in blood bank. And then there are also project sponsors or champions. These are usually people or departments that are affected by the problem that is being investigated. So there are five phases of the improvement methodology. We're going to look at them in detail. So there's D is define. That is the first phase. And what do you define? So you define the end users of the services or products in the lab. That could be patients, but it could also be the physicians that are ordering the test. What are their needs and expectations? So out of that, you can get the problem statement. What are the project boundaries? The importance of the project, the scope of the project, what it will do, what it won't do. And then the process, you're going to define the process. So what's the project schedule? What are the resources that are needed, etc. The next phase is M for measure. In this one, you're going to collect data, so baseline data, determine the defects, and assess satisfaction. So that would be baseline satisfaction. And then in the analyze phase, you need to dive deep into the data to identify the root causes of error. Once you've identified the root causes of error, then you can move to the next one, which is I for improve, in which you will fix problems and then prevent future ones with creative solutions. So this is when solutions are implemented, and then C as control, where there will be continuous monitoring of the new plans to make sure that the solutions are indeed solutions and they have fixed the problem. So let's look a little bit more into what happens in each phase. So in the define phase, you're going to create a charter which would define the overall purpose, scope, and impact of the project. Next, you're going to create a SIPOC. So it's a supply input process output customer map to see the process through the consumer's eyes. So are you going to look at the process through the patient's eyes that's getting tested, or are you going to look at the process through the physician's eyes as they're ordering tests and waiting for the results to come back? Okay. You want to listen and gather the voice of the consumer to identify the key drivers of customer satisfaction. What is it that they're mad about? What is it that they think should be changed? And you really just need to dive deep into that. And then do a critical to quality tree to clarify the voice of the consumer, and then find measurables. What are things that you can measure? And so this could be, for example, a lot of times if you want to assess satisfaction, you can use surveys. Well, this would be like, what questions do you want on the surveys? Because the questions that you ask, it will determine the data that you collect and the answers that you get. So you want to ask the right questions, and so you want to find the things that you need to ask about. And so those would be your measurables, and hopefully you can measure those, even if it's with scales of 1 to 5, satisfaction scales or something like that. Right, so next in the measure phase, you're going to map and analyze the current process as it is. And with the mapping, then once you've mapped it, you can develop a data collection plan. What data are you going to gather, where, when? And then you're actually going to collect that data, and that will give you your baseline data. And then you're going to calculate the process sigma of the baseline data. So the higher the process sigma, the less variation there is, and the better the outcome. So the process sigmas can be 1 sigma, 2 sigma, 3 sigma, 4 sigma, 5 sigma, and 6 sigma. 6 sigma is the highest quality, 1 sigma is the lowest quality. And the process sigma will focus on defects and customer expectations. In the analyze phase, you want to brainstorm for potential root causes of error. So where's error coming from? Where's the dissatisfaction coming from? And then you may have several ideas, and then you're going to want to agree on at least 1 or 2 potential root causes, and then create a hypothesis and test it. So if we change it to this, then will this happen? And so you want to do that by looking for differences in relationships in the data. Is there a problem every time a certain physician is on versus other physicians? Or is it a shift problem? Is there a problem on day shift versus night shift? Is there a problem weekday versus weekend? Just look, you just got to dig in the data and see what it tells you, looking for pattern differences. Then you're going to move into the improve phase. So once you've selected some potential root causes, you want to develop strategies to fix each identified problem, but then prioritize them, because you don't want to try to fix everything at once, because then you don't know what worked. So you want to prioritize what could we fix first, right? And then next and next, and then roll them in a time sequence. You want to pilot the changes, meaning you want to implement them at a small scale and see if it actually works, see if your solution actually works. And then analyze the pilot and what's going on there, and maybe fine-tune it, and then you can develop the program into a full-scale plan. And you want to collect data during the pilots to make sure that the process is improving during the pilot, because then maybe if it's not, maybe you selected the wrong solution. what you think is a problem is not actually the problem, or what you think the solution is not actually the solution. And then last, you're going to go into the control phase, and it makes sure that the gains that were made are maintained. And then any changes in the process that happen through this improvement methodology are going to be documented in the procedures, so the standard operating procedures of the lab, and the staff is going to be trained to the new way of doing things, to the new procedures. Visuals need to be posted to remind the staff, because this is something new, so they're not used to thinking about it. And then you can also use dashboards to share the improvements and the gains that have happened. And then it's also good to do a lessons learned and share it with the people on the QI team, but then also the staff and the people involved in the project. So how do we detect lab errors? An estimated 12.5% of lab errors impact patient healthcare, but only 37.5 out of every 100,000 errors place patients at risk due to analytic mistakes. Previously, lab quality improvement focused on the analytical phase. That is where quality control lives. But this is only 4 to 32% of all lab errors. Most lab errors occur in the pre or post analytical phases. So the pre-analytical phase, which is test ordering and sample collection, has the most, 32 to 75% of all errors. And the post-analytical phase, which is test interpretation, which could be also be test reporting, but test interpretation by the physicians also, it has 9 to 55% of all errors. So if you were to put them in order as to where errors are most likely to happen, it's going to be pre-analytical first, post-analytical second, and then analytical phase last. And so when you consider quality improvement, the whole process of lab testing should always be considered in the quality improvement project. So how do we define the sigma performance of an assay? So Six Sigma can help determine how well an assay is performing. And then the sigma value can assist in choosing the appropriate Westgaard QC rules to help you flag when problems are developing. So those are based on the published chart. You can go look it up and do a search to Six Sigma to Westgaard and how that translates. It maximizes the chances of detecting an error and minimizes the risk of rejecting a result that is correct. Okay, and Six Sigma metrics can be plotted using an OP specs chart, and that includes total allowable error, systematic error, which is inaccuracy, and random error, which is imprecision. This plot then reveals the sigma metric of the assay. Again, it's going to go from anywhere from 1 sigma to 6 sigma, and then that's going to be used to determine then the Westgaard QC rules to use. The sigma value of an assay can be calculated during using this equation. So the sigma equals the total allowable error minus the bias divided by the coefficient of variation. And this is where bias is the systematic error of the assay. Next, let's look at quality control plans. The quality control plans aim to reduce the chance of possible errors and failures in the testing process. It should ensure the accuracy and reliability of test results in the context of patient care. It can include an instrument's electronic controls, internal controls. So internal controls are controls that are usually built into the test. So as an example of an internal control, I have this pregnancy test where two lines means pregnant, one line means non-pregnant, and that one line is that internal quality control. If you have no lines, it's an invalid test, right? So that's the internal quality control that's built into a test, as an example. It can include also proficiency testing, calibration, maintenance, and then user training and competency assessment. So let's look at QA and IQCP. So QA, or quality assessment, or quality assurance also, is the continuous process of monitoring the effectiveness of the quality control plan. It can include the review of quality control on each analyzer around the lab, the review of the proficiency testing for each test across the lab, chart audits, specimen rejection log review, turnaround time reports, complaints, variance reports, and safety reports. Labs should do risk assessments to identify risks across the lab, and they will also need to review the effectiveness of any corrective action as part of quality assurance. The IQCP is individualized quality control plan, and it allows the labs to design a quality control plan that fits their needs and remains CLIA and CMS compliant. So let's finish up with some key lean lessons. So one, it's not possible to over communicate. Two, continuously focus on improvements. We're never done there. Always something to make better. Three, engage all facets of an organization, not just a core team. Four, action speaks louder than words. Five, ideas flow from the bottom up, because the people at the bottom are the ones doing the hard work, and they usually know where the problems are, and often they have some good creative ideas for those solutions on how to fix the problem. So six, be respectful to every individual and listen to and seriously consider their ideas. Seven, a feedback loop is critical to overcome challenges. And eight, staff must be accountable to achieve success. So, all right, that wraps up our Lean and Six Sigma. I hope you found that to be helpful. And next, I'm going to start a series on the different types of analyzers and analytic techniques, etc. So I'll see you there.